Let's go. Let's head to the nation's capital. Coach, I really appreciate you finding the time here because I know how frantic it must be, but you're playing ball, Lapo. Were you ever worried that you weren't going to be?
No, I think always we thought we were going to play. And yeah, the hectic time now is like we've done so much work preparing. Now you're trying to go, all right, do I have everything organized at the house? Because you've been procrastinating. Oh, my God, I'm going to disappear for months now, right? So that's kind of what's going on at our household.
You know what that reminds me of is Etch. He used to go, bill collectors love me during the season because his mailbox is overflowing with bills, right, and stuff because right. You can't do anything.
Yeah, absolutely. I remember, like, I can remember working in Saskatchewan and after a season, like you're like, you go wash the car for the first time in 8 months, right? It's just crazy, like how everything stops during football.
Well, that's good. This is what you want. Listen, I got to ask you, the viewers want me to ask you this. A comment that Dickie said got him in a little heat. He said, vets that aren't in shape, probably going to get cut. Sorry. And Luke Mullender took issue with that. What's your status on going into training camp with guys that haven't been able to train up to what they normally would?
Well, I think you're going to evaluate where your team is. I mean, if there's a veteran who's got some talented players behind him that have some experience, yeah, I think that could be a problematic spot if they didn't do any work in the offseason. But, you know, I think every team's different where you're, you know, some people are going to be more secure. Some people aren't. It's just, you know, like, It's the nature of the beast. You know, you can't be in this business and not be comfortable with change. And the players have to understand that they're always trying to, you know, clubs are always trying to get better, and they're always competing for their spots on a weekly basis. You know, Dickie comes out and says that you know, that's usually what happens in pro football. So that's change business.
So what I was saying, it's not new. I think we're just being reminded of the harshness of this business that you're in. But by the way, you must have saw the quote from Willie Jefferson the other day that says, oh, Ottawa doesn't want to play us, eh? What was your reaction to that?
I love Willie. Nah, whatever. You know, like, hey, we can't control the schedule. We'll play who we get to play. And, obviously I got a lot of friends in that organization and that place. It's been neat to go back there and see everybody, but not in the cards. So, no, and we are not afraid of playing Willie and the Winnipeg Blue Bombers. So hopefully we see him down the stretch.
I don't think you're afraid of anybody, and I know that, but how are you feeling about the weapons at your disposal and your roster here as you get ready for training camp?
Yeah, you know, what's kind of interesting going through it is you're going to have a little bit more early on. Normally, you know, to go to camp with 100 guys, you've got to plan how you're going to do it with 100 guys. And, you know, we've added some pieces that we think can help us at spots. We've got to get help on defense, and Cleon Lang does that. Donya Numba, we felt was a good add for the deal. On offense, obviously, one of the keys for us was getting better quarterback play in the building, and Matt Nichols certainly does that for us.
You have that history with Matt Nichols, so where do you see him in the progression of his career, Lapo? You know him incredibly well. Is he anywhere near the top of his potential, do you think?
Well, you know, I think the neat thing about, you know, some people talk about, yeah, it's great to see you develop this guy or this guy. Sometimes developing guys is not a lot of fun, right? They go through, you know, bad games. They are inconsistent, everything. And so the nice thing about Matt is, you know, like he understands what wins football games. He understands how we want to go about winning football games. And he certainly has played very good football and, you know, has won a lot of football games. So, you know, and I do think at times, you know, because we ran the ball so well in 19, you know, in 18, that he doesn't get as much credit because we were doing so many other great things with that. But he certainly, in I believe 2017, was one of the top throwers in the league and, was outstanding in the team that led the league in scoring. So every year is different. We expect him to be able to do whatever we need to do to win football games.
And you talk about the backfield and Andrew Harris. Nobody's ever won Grey Cup, MOP, MVP, and top Canadian ever. So there's that feather in his cap. But what do you refresh us? What do you got in your backfield there? Crockett? Who else?
No, we have Akeem Hunt. Is a guy from Purdue. Just an outstanding speed. Guy spent some time in the NFL. And then we have Timothy Flanders, if you guys remember, from who was spent some time with us in Winnipeg, was on and off the roster, actually played some slot for us, was Andrew's backup. But with the ratio, it was somebody we had to move on from, and just an outstanding football player and a great person. So, you know, we feel comfortable there with those two guys, guys that we think a good young player and a guy's got some experience in our system. And when he played for Andrew, he's dynamic.
Well, while we're at it, let's just go through a few other positions. You mentioned Matt Nichols. Who else is in your quarterback room?
We have Dom Davis, who is, you know, obviously with me before and been in, and we'll give Dom a good opportunity to come in and compete. We have a kid named Taryn Christian from South Dakota. Not South Dakota, that was Strava, South Dakota State, and had a great college career. So he's been in our organization, you know, about a year now. And we also signed a kid named Chase Litton from Marshall to be another guy to compete. So, yeah, we'll let these guys come in. And we've tried to have some as many meetings we can to get these guys ahead of the game. But now we'll let the bullets fly with the quarterbacks when we get them in here.
Sorry to go back, but I don't know where you are on a two-quarterback system. But the 2019 season, Lapo, I'm sure you – well, we think it's your greatest job of coaching ever. I don't know what you think. You didn't want to have to rotate all those quarterbacks, but you did. I mean, will you ever go through a situation like that? I mean, ideally, Matt Nichols takes every snap all year, I would think. Or do you like to rotate in a second guy?
Well – you know, first of all, people will talk about a rotation. The reason Chris Strebler, let's say Matt Nichols played every play of the season, Chris Strebler would have played, and we, you know, certainly on a after a quarterback sneak, we would have put Strebler in the game and kept him in the game. You know, but you're going to do that if you have a player who you're so impressed with and you know he's going to step on the field and make plays. Now, Strebler ran a 4.440. It was 215 pounds, so you don't get that often. So we knew that's a guy, let's get him the ball. Now, if your backup quarterbacks aren't like him, yeah, you're maybe not. You know, I don't think you want to take your starter out of the game if he's the best quarterback. He's the guy, you know, that you want to keep touching the ball. So, you know, Chris was in a unique situation, and we were fortunate enough to, you know, be able to get him some snaps. And the three quarterbacks, yeah, I have not been through that a lot, and but hopefully we don't have to do that.
Are you looking at Dom Davis as a third down guy, or what role do you see for him?
You know, I've always said this, and I know some people have lived in the world of, all right, you have to have a quarterback sneak guy, or you have to have that change up to your starter. I think it's so hard in the Canadian Football League to develop the next guy that I try not to live in that world. You know, people say, well, you had Strebler. Well, that's because we felt he could be a starter in the Canadian Football League. So, you know, it's you get a starter. We like some athletic ability and running ability in our starter. So hopefully that comes into the building naturally. But it's I would say it's not something we're just saying we have to have a mobile guy to do that. But Dom Davis has done some of that stuff for us before.
Interesting, by the way, you mentioned Strebler. He's still in Arizona. They just cut, I think, their third string quarterback. He's still there. So, you know, we're all pulling for him. And I know we talked with you about it when he was playing, and we're not thinking about the Arizona Cardinals. We're thinking about the CFL right now. But Daryl in Toronto's watching from the Beneath Sports podcast, and he says, hey, Coach, is there anything you learned from broadcasting that you've brought into coaching? I'd love to hear this answer.
I would say this. The first thing that coaching, working in television allowed me to do is it really gave me the ability to have the time to watch every game in the league. So I always had a notebook out, and when a game situation thing came up, I would have been like, okay, I wrote that down. Let me go ahead and talk through this. Like, let me make sure, you know, I would cover this if this ever happened again. I thought that was the first thing that was pretty neat. Now, how it relates to what did I learn most from dealing with all those guys and oh, those awesome guys, my man Schulte and all those boys. I would say this, that TSN does an outstanding job promoting our game. And there are people who are very passionate about the CFL that work there or work on the CFL at TSN. That's the one thing I really took from 3 years working with those guys. You know, I've always believed media is part of what you have to do to be successful as a league and as successful as a coach. It's part of our job to promote the league. So, you know, I didn't open my eyes in that respect, but it did open my eyes on how much there's a lot of passion for our game at the CFL.
Well, you know what? You're right. Those guys love the CFL as much as they love the World Juniors and the NHL and any of their other properties. They hold it right there. You're right. Lapo, just before I let you go, our viewers are just, it's driving them nuts. They want to know where you're watching from. Or some have said, is he outside TD Place? Is he in a cave? Is he in a park? Where are you joining us from?
Yes, well, Friday is usually for me, like, I try to help my wife do anything. I do football in the morning. I am outside IKEA, for those who don't know. Like, so there's not, I don't think there's an IKEA in Regina. So, yeah, I stepped out because I love Rod so much. So I can spend some time with you guys and get ready for the season. You know, here in Ottawa, we're, you know, like I saw some people yesterday, REDBLACKS fans came up and said great things. You know, we're excited to get going. You know, we appreciate all the people where they're putting us at. And, you know, I've been a head coach before in a team in the East and that was picked last, and we finished first in the East going to the Grey Cup. So we're just looking forward to getting started and seeing how the whole season plays out and believing, you know, that, you know, we'll be a good team that'll be reckoned.
I lied. One more. Pinball did not hide last hour. He's like, we got a bad schedule. We're playing seven of our games are against the two teams that are in the Grey Cup or whatever it was. He wasn't hiding that going into the season. What's your schedule like? How do you feel about yours?
You know, it's kind of hard to have a bye week in this season, week two. But not bad for a new staff, I guess. But we have a bye week two. But I believe we're the only game in the team in the CFL that plays three games in 11 days. So that is very difficult, very problematic. And, you know, like, how do you prepare that way? It gives you, you know, and two of them are road games. I know one of them is a back-to-back, but to play back-to-back five games within 5 days is very hard on preparation, very hard on the players. So that's kind of the bad apple that showed up for us in the schedule. But whatever, a schedule is a schedule. We got to find a way to win our games, and we will.
Yeah, like you say, everybody's got something that they're dealing with. So, Lapo, I appreciate this. Thanks. Please thank Tina for sharing you with us. And good luck. Can't wait to see you on the field.
Awesome, guys. Take care. See you later.
Thank you, buddy. The head coach of the Ottawa REDBLACKS, Paul LaPolice. And as much as we've forgotten kind of who's where in the last year and a half, that's one that just, boom, burned in my brain. Yeah. Lapo, Ottawa. It seems like a really good fit.
You're watching Rod Pedersen On Demand. For more of The Rod Pedersen Show, visit rodpedersen.com or follow Rod Pedersen on social media.